It's a quiet Saturday morning, a pleasant 82 degrees in Ferguson, Missouri. Patrol Officer Darren Wilson, who began work at 6:30 a.m., responds to a mid-shift 911 call. It's from a woman at Park Ridge Apartments. A man is out to shoot her. By the time the 28-year-old patrol officer arrives, the suspect is gone, and the complainant declines to pursue charges. Wilson clears the call, ready for whatever crops up next in the 911 queue. He is dispatched right away to the North Winds apartment complex. A 2-year-old is having difficulty breathing. Emergency medical personnel will soon be on the scene. Wilson gets there quickly, sticks around, reassures the mother before watching the ambulance drive off with its little patient. Back in his marked Chevy Tahoe, Wilson motors down Canfield Drive, where he spots a couple of young black men strolling down the middle of the street. Not safe for them, plus they're interfering with traffic. The officer stops about 12 yards away, gets out of his car, and approaches. "Hey, Mike." "Yeah," the bigger of the two guys says. He is 18-year-old Michael Brown, his companion 22-year-old Dorian Johnson. "What you want?" Brown says. "Just wondering why you're walking in the middle of the street. Why don't you try the sidewalk? It's safer there." "Fuck what you have to say," Brown says. He doesn't shout it, but he doesn't whisper it either. Wilson calls for backup, then smiles at Brown. "Really, I'm not here to cause any problems." And he isn't. He loves working the Canfield Green community, enjoys the diversity of the area. As a white cop in a black neighborhood, he gets it. He understands the chip on the shoulder attitudes, especially among young black men. His fellow cops have labeled Canfield Green anti-police, their most charitable pet name. They stop and frisk everything that moves and write traffic citations by the bucketful, generating revenue, safeguarding their salaries, adding to the economic hardship of the area's low-income residents. They make skinny arrests, most for low-level, nonviolent drug offenses, and a panoply of constitutionally shaky municipal code violations, often fabricating probable cause if they bother with it at all. They misuse their batons, their dogs, their tasers, and they pepper their speech and emails with racial slurs, ridiculing the nation's first black president and his wife, and the nation's first two black attorneys general. But Wilson, one of the department's 50 white cops, four others are black in a community of 2/3 African Americans, he works hard to get along with the residents, forging positive relations, aiming to build trust. In fact, he believes a big part of his job is to create a partnership with the people on his beat, to work collaboratively with them to solve problems. More than anything, he wants to put an end to the deep-seated historical animosity between this community and its police department. "Seriously," he says, "I just want you guys to be safe." "Then why are you always hassling us?" Brown says, his tone softening slightly. "We ain't done nothing wrong." Wilson notices that Brown is clutching a fistful of cigarillos. During his last call, the officer overheard other units being dispatched to a theft from the Ferguson Market and Liquor, a convenience store not far from Canfield. The loot, cigarillos. The crime report has been upgraded from misdemeanor shoplifting to strong-arm robbery, a felony. Wilson plays it cool, alert, fully aware of his surroundings. he nevertheless assumes a non-threatening stance and speaks in calm, soothing tones. Last thing I'm going to do is hassle you guys. You got my word. They chat like that briefly, Brown continuing to goad Wilson, the officer refusing to get sucked in. 90 seconds after his request, a backup unit pulls in, followed immediately by another. Wilson briefs his fellow cops, one of whom had taken the report at the convenience store. Over his shoulder, glancing over at Brown, he asks, "Our guy?" The officer nods. Wilson informs Brown what he's learned about the crime that was captured on CCTV, and the youth shakes his head and sighs. He surrenders the cigarillos and puts his hands behind his back. Wilson cuffs him without incident. The cop and the prisoner talk on the way to jail. "Seriously, Mike, what's it like out here for you? I mean, dealing with your police department." "My police department? That's some crack-ass bullshit." He pauses. Wilson says nothing. Then Brown says, "Truth is, it's messed up, man. You guys jack us around all the time for nothing. It's nigga this and nigga that. Always stopping us for no reason, throwing us to the ground, busting us for failure to comply." "Tell you what," Wilson said as he removes the cuffs inside the new Sallyport at the jail at police headquarters, "I'll have a talk with the prosecutor. Not making any promises, but it might help. But you gotta know what you did in that store was bad, real bad. You gotta promise no more. Word?" Brown hesitates for the longest time, then nods. "Word, Officer Wilson, no more." Wilson has heard it before, but he believes the kid. The next day, he chats up the prosecutor, puts in a good word for the young defendant. Originally charged with robbery, Brown cops a negotiated plea to misdemeanor theft. He pays a small fine, gets credit for time served, and is assigned 3 weekends of community service. In the fall, on probation for the theft, Michael Brown starts classes at St. Louis's Vatertot College, where he studies HVAC. He goes on to graduate and becomes a technician in his community, specializing in keeping his neighbors' homes warm in the winter and cool in the summer. Officer Darren Wilson continues his career as a Ferguson police officer and earns praise from the African-American community for his spirit of cooperation, his sensitivity, and compassion. And life goes on in Ferguson, a small town in the middle of the country that few have or ever will hear about. That rosy, what might have been story, of course, is a false narrative. It's one that I think everyone in this room can wish and certainly does had played out on August 9th of 2014 when Darren Wilson shot and killed Michael Brown. It began a firestorm of protest around the country. Criticism of police policies, police practices, police customs, traditions. Criticism of city policies. Ferguson was a police department mired in policing for profit. Citations, arrests, calculated to generate revenue to keep the city afloat, and yes, to pay a portion thereof, the salaries of the police officers. Can you imagine a more unconscionable system of budgeting for police protection and service? But that's exactly what Ferguson was doing. And in fact, if you want to know how bad policing can get and how it can get that bad, read the March 4th, 2015 Department of Justice report on Ferguson. It's a searing 102, 107-page report of these policies and these practices. They get real. They spend 30,000 hours on this investigation. They interview many people from the community, many police officers, and they ask them explicitly about their own habits and practices in policing their beats in the city of Ferguson. The picture that emerges is truly ugly. And it would be wonderful to say that Ferguson was an anomaly, that police work like that does not take place anywhere else in the country. Or if it does, it takes place in backwater towns throughout the United States. It certainly doesn't take place in other cities. Not long after that report was released, Bill Bratton, Commissioner of Police, departing Commissioner of Police in New York, gathered his 800 command staff members, 800 members of the command staff, together at the brand new police academy and told them, no more bigotry, no more racism, no more corruption, no more incompetence. I've had it up to here. It ends here, it ends now. A very strong speech. In that same speech, Bratton did what far too many police administrators do. He went on to say, now I know and you know that the vast, 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 three vasts, the vast, vast, vast majority of our police officers are honorable, decent. They're effective crime fighters. They are respectful service providers. The vast, vast, vast majority of our cops do us proud. This is the same commissioner who, during his first term in office back in 1994, raided with members of his internal affairs staff the 30th precinct and snatched the badges off the chests of police officers and had them melted down, no longer to be issued to NYPD officers. Why? Because they were part of the Dirty 30, which is how they became known. An entire precinct whose individuals include, according to Bratton's own estimate, 30% who are engaged in misconduct. By that math, I don't know how you can get by with one vast majority. I just don't see it. And what it put me in mind of, and I got, I was telling somebody today, I had 91 phone calls from media from around the world, from Brazil to BBC, Al Jazeera, all over the place, from about August the 13th through the end of 2014. My publisher from my first book, called and said, we need a new book from you. I said, I'm writing fiction now. I said, that my critics will tell you that this and Breaking Rank are fiction. But I can tell you that I absolutely did not want to write this book. And what I told her is, I have fallen in love with fiction writing. And by the way, I can make stuff up. I mean, it doesn't have to be real. I can invent characters. And I can have them tell stories that are important to me, that have clear political overtones, but more personal overtones as well. I was thoroughly enjoying the process, and it got interrupted with this phone call. And Alessandra, my executive editor at Nation Books, said, I'm going to call you every 2 months until you say yes. 2 months later, she called, and I said no. 2.5 weeks later, I called her and said, I cave. Whether it's this book or any other, any honest effort at understanding the systemic implications of racism, sexism, homophobia, other brands of bigotry, any effort to understand police corruption, to understand police apathy or lack of empathy, is a worthwhile effort. And so for me, on a personal level, I felt I had to write this book, and I'm glad that I've written it. I do plan to go back to fiction, and I do plan to use my fiction as a way of conveying a lot of these same messages in ways that people might find more captivating or riveting, I would hope. But more than anything else, it got me thinking of how we've come to where we are. Indulge me a few moments of police history. I will make it brief. Back when, throughout the South, slave patrols represented policing, and watchman-style watchers represented policing in the North. And the Industrial Revolution was upon us. It became very clear that relying on neighbors watching out for neighbors just wasn't going to cut it. Not anymore. The enormous lawlessness and disorder associated with industrialization, with moving from an agrarian to an urban society, was creating untold pressures, particularly, obviously, in big population centers. New York, Philadelphia, Boston. Those are the three big first police departments in this country. City officials went to England to study the Metropolitan Police Act of 1829. The Metropolitan Police Act took Sir Robert Peel, the Home Secretary, later to become Prime Minister for two terms, of Great Britain, the better part of a decade to persuade a very bulky parliament to buy the idea, even the notion, of organized policing. And I think the reason for Parliament's reluctance will resonate with today's Americans. They did not want to see a militarized force on city streets. They didn't want to see their police officers treating their fellow citizens as enemy combatants. They cherished their privacy. They cherished their civil liberties. They were afraid that some police officers would become corrupt, would take bribes and engage in other forms of misconduct. So they were absolutely unwilling at first to go along with this idea of an organized, uniform police force. Finally, as a result principally of Sir Robert Peel engineering into that act of 1829, very stringent safeguards and methods of supervising the soon to become known bobbies. Get it? Sir Robert Peel. The big tall helmets. Those are selected for a reason. They started with top hats, then they went to helmets. The idea was, in Peel's vision, I want police officers who are exemplary. I want them as models, whether height was the appropriate criterion is we can debate. But he had in mind this idea that police officers would be model citizens. They would be patient. They would be decent. They would help people solve problems. They would alleviate fear. They would solve crimes. They would return stolen property. They would do all kinds of good stuff for the community. And it was good. The emissaries from Boston, from Philadelphia, from New York studied that act of 1829, and they were not good students at all. It was like they systematically set about to eliminate every safeguard that Peel had engineered into the act. But they're saying, well, we just adopted the Metropolitan Police Act. We're going to tailor it to our own purposes and our own needs. And of course, those purposes and needs essentially represented a political spoils system for hiring, for promotions, for transfers, for assignments. A familial spoils system as much as a political spoils system to look at the early history. A police captaincy in the early days, 19th century, New York, went for $15,000. That was mid-19th century dollars. So from the very beginning, that institution was corrupt, it was brutal, and it was bigoted. And while Sir Robert Peel and his first police chiefs are firing 2,200 of the first 2,800 bobbies they hired, sending home the message, We're serious. No drinking on the job, no brutalizing your fellow citizens, no lying, cheating, stealing. So they in fact, developed a very solid model. In this country, not so much. So when the big three departments established their agencies, formalized their agencies, put these police officers into uniform, they got off on the very wrong foot, and from my point of view, the institution itself has been misguided all these many years later. That is reinforced by the Wickersham Commission of the 1930s. It's reinforced by the Mullen Commission, by the Knapp Commission in New York, by the 21st century, the president's 21st century task force on policing, by Rahm Emanuel's task force on corruption in the Chicago Police Department, and brutality and excessive force and lethal force and cold-blooded murder. It's reinforced every time we turn around. The Mullen Commission said, what's it going to take? Every time a new commission, a task force, issues a report and says that the institution is suffering from systemic ills, what is it going to take for us to mend those systemic ills? And that's essentially what I would like to talk with you tonight. I didn't look at my time when I started, Deborah, so I'm gonna bring it to a close here in just a moment. But what I would really want to say to you by way of closing before we get into a conversation about these issues is that throughout the 34 years that I was a cop and since, I have met the most wonderful, heroic, sensitive, and compassionate police officers in pretty much every part of the country. I have met police officers who have sacrificed all. I have been to cop funerals. I have spent time with the loved ones, the families of police officers slain in the line of duty. When the five Dallas officers hit the pavement a couple of months ago, I was heartsick. It absolutely tears me up to hear people shouting, pigs in a blanket, fry them up, as was done in Minneapolis during a protest in response to controversial police shootings. That's not the answer. It is absolutely not the answer. We have got to find a way in this country to develop empathy for one another and to appreciate that if we continue to get bad apples generation after generation, coast to coast and border to border, we might want to look at the barrel, and that's where I'm coming from. Policing as an institution is in dire need of a major structural overhaul. Tweaking the system, tinkering with the system will not accomplish it. And we owe it to the good cops to get on about that work. Thank you very much.
Thank you. In light of the recent ambush-style attacks on police and mass shootings involving body armor worn by attackers, how do we get the public and police officers themselves to buy in to the demilitarization of the police?
There are times and places for military appearance, military weaponry, and military tactics. I was present in the immediate aftermath of the so-called McDonald's massacre in 1984. I have never seen such carnage. Little children, moms and dads in mid-bite strawberry shakes melding with blood on the floor of an iconic fast food restaurant. It was horrific. And one of the questions we asked ourselves in the debriefing and the critiquing and the second guessing and the hand-wringing and teeth gnashing is, could we have reduced the carnage at least? And the answer from my SWAT people, this was in San Diego, I spent the first 28 years of my career there, was an emphatic yes. We could have, had we had an armored personnel carrier, we could have driven that vehicle up to the door or through the door and taken out James Huberty much earlier. And so we set about acquiring one of those vehicles and upgraded it over the years. Here's the problem. When you start trotting out all that military equipment and you embrace military tactics, for example, one of those famous pre-dawn drug raids predicated on somebody having observed somebody with a half a baggie of marijuana go into or out from an apartment complex or some such thing, that is a misuse of the equipment. It's a misuse of the tactics from my point of view. If you have evidence that somebody is barricaded, has weaponry, has ammunition, has hostages, then it, for me, is not only understandable, it's necessary. First, to do everything in your power to talk them out, to use hostage negotiators, very well trained, very well disciplined hostage negotiators, to coax them out if that's at all possible, and to prevent bloodshed. So I always start with there's a time and a place for the equipment and the weapons and the like. A time and a place that it is not a proper use of that equipment is Ferguson in the middle of a peaceful protest. When you see a sniper, a police officer armed with a sniper rifle high atop an MRAP, mine-resistant, ambush-protected vehicle, and surveying a crowd of nonviolent demonstrators, fellow Americans exercising their First Amendment rights. So that's not your question.
It's your stage.
No, but it certainly does affect me when we use police in that way, and it affects the community. It affects the mentality of the officers. We need at some point tonight to talk about the drug war and what that's done, I think, to American police officers. But I think if the question is how do we deal with that with all the escalation of the controversial shootings and then the ambush killings of police officers, is by bringing community together with police officers and having a much larger community conversation. I'm not talking about kumbaya, I'm not talking about touchy-feely kinds of conversations that are intended to soothe feelings. I'm really talking about the opposite. I think citizens need to let their local police department know that they're not happy with some of the practices that they see. And I think police officers have got to learn, to the extent that they need this skill, to actively listen and to listen with empathy. So I think it's organization, mobilization, education, and a fair amount of agitation thrown in for good measure. These protests are having an effect. The protests are producing task forces and solid recommendations. I mean, when I said basically, you know, I would just put it this way, we'll be back 5 years or 10 or 15 years from now if all we do is embrace those recommendations. They're good, they're solid, I don't really disagree with any of them, but we need much more than that.
So just following up about the militarization, I was interested that there wasn't a lot of discussion after the shooting of the police officers in Dallas, that I believe my facts are correct on this, that they used like an automated robot to take care of the shooter. Is that the right time and the place?
I was on the Chelsea Handler show last month, and Bill Maher was a fellow guest. And he turned to me and said, is this the future of policing? We're going to send bombs in to kill people? I would ask everyone to keep in mind that the person who was killed killed five police officers. Could just as easily have struck utterly innocent people. Police officers, by the way, who were running toward the gunfire. Police officers who were protecting people who were protesting police practices. There's irony there to be sure, but that really embodies, that symbolizes what we really want our police officers to do. So I didn't take him on about whether it was the right thing to use, in effect, automation to take out a human being, but if this human being committed the ultimate act of dehumanization, then maybe that robot was the safest, smartest thing that chief could have done. It's like body cameras. 10 years ago, I absolutely opposed them. Then I went into a neutral state for a while, and now I'm a strong supporter. And I went through my own little evolutionary process. And I think I need to do that today with this issue.
Yeah, with body cameras, I've devolved. And I was a big supporter. Now I'm in another place on it. So I'll look forward to it. I'm going to read two questions that are sort of along the similar theme, but I think it's important to hear them both. One, could you speak about the lack of consequences for officers who killed Eric Garner and in other shocking cases of nonviolent people? And the second one is, my son was shot and killed by the Seattle police on New Year's 2009. He was a senior at the UW and was firing blanks. The inquest was a mockery of the justice system. What can be done to change the process?
Well, first, my heart goes out to that parent. Thank you. There are two things I think a lot of people don't realize. I'm now talking about the public at large. And one of them is that police officers are taught to fire their weapons when they believe their life or the life of another person is in imminent danger. They're taught that. There is repetition of the teaching. They are taught that if you hesitate in shoot, no shoot scenarios, you could be dead, or that another innocent person could be dead. The use of lethal force by American police officers particularly is problematic for so many reasons, not the least of which is the number of guns that we have in this society. So I think it's important that everybody understand that police officers are taught to shoot to stop the threat. When I became a cop in 1966, which I appreciate is ancient history, we were taught shoot to kill. Don't take your gun out unless you intend to use it, and if you use it, shoot to kill. Several things have changed since 1966. Many, many things have changed since then. One of them is firepower. We were carrying six shooters. So two shots could, in fact, disable or otherwise immobilize somebody or not. Two shots may simply be not enough to stop the threat. And I suspect that that went into the reasoning. Several years later, that did change, and shoot to stop the threat became the operative phrase. And what that usually meant by way of instruction was police officers now having converted to semi-automatic pistols, is you double tap. Bang, bang at center mass, typically, to stop the threat. This is hard to talk about for a lot of people who have no appreciation of firearms, who value human life, who are deeply saddened by what they see going on in this country, but it's important, realistic conversation that we must have. I would never think about sending a police officer out on the streets if I didn't believe that he or she was capable of using force, including lethal force, if absolutely necessary. So, I guess one of the most difficult things to deal with is people's perceptions that police officers can shoot a gun out of somebody's hand or can shoot to wound. That stuff of television and bad television at that, it really is. So, if I'm a police officer, I pull up and somebody is firing a gun, the chances are pretty good that I'm going to use my weapon.
Can I just clarify, so that sure. You go on and on about the details and the injustices that happened that evening? I could go on and on. My question was about the inquest itself. And because my husband and I naively thought we will wait till we have our day in court, when a judge can hear, a jury can hear this evidence, not because it was a mistake of his to be shooting blanks. on New Year's Eve. At the camp near the Camel Creek Grove of the UW. That was a mistake. Nothing that happened in that courtroom could bring him back. I know that. But the inquest process was so frustrating. The evidence that was thrown out, the testimony by the officers involved, how many times they answered, I do not recall. I do not recall. I do not recall. I was amazed. And then the judge threw out so much evidence that I thought Mike Green shed some light on some misdoing, excessive force by the police officers, how quickly they fired at him when he was at the bottom of the stairwell coming out of his basement apartment. He didn't even know they were out there. So I'm asking about the inquest process.
And of course, I'm not an expert on the inquest process. No, I actually haven't. I haven't personally witnessed an inquest. They are held by the county, and I can tell you that from my research into controversial shootings over the last 2 or 3 years, a large number of those shootings should have resulted in consequences for the officers. I don't know the facts and circumstances of the case you're talking about, but I would acknowledge that there have been several cases in which police officers have not only engaged in excessive force, lethal force in some of them, but have been covered by the lies of their fellow officers. And that is utterly unacceptable. And I think it is incumbent upon police administrators and communities and elected officials to put pressure on police administrators to make sure that the responsible thing is done. If the cop's shooting is defensible, so be it. But if you think about the Laquan McDonald shooting in Chicago, the Walter Scott shooting in North Charleston, South Carolina, you are looking at two instances of cold-blooded murder. When we get into the grayer areas, that's where it's really important that we have accurate, thorough, top-quality, and timely investigations. And I personally support independent investigations and independent prosecution. I think take it out of the hands of the local agency. We clearly need institutions that have credibility. And for better or worse, many agencies have lost that credibility, and the best thing to do, and not just for appearances, but to get a quality investigation, is to go that route.
This is a related question. Will you support I-873, which would make it easier for prosecutors to investigate and prosecute police officers who have used deadly force? And this is the law that says they would have to show malice, and that's being looked at at a state commission level.
Right. Dan Satterberg calls these cases awful but lawful, and that's accurate. The state of Washington has arguably the most a significant hurdle for a prosecutor to pass in order to prosecute a police officer. I looked at I read an account online of the Ian Burke shooting of John T. Williams back in 2010. And I thought, well, God, that's a tragedy, but you don't come at a police officer with a knife. Then I saw the video, and then I read the witness's statements. And I thought, as the department concluded, this is one of the most egregious police shootings we had seen in modern times in the city of Seattle. And there could have been a prosecution had the law been different. I'm accepting at face value what Satterberg is saying. There are times when I think prosecutors exercise their discretion a little bit in ways that misunderstand the importance of their role in helping to exercise control over law enforcement. So there have been times when I've been in disagreement with prosecutors in this city and others, but I think Satterberg was right. It was an awful, lawful shooting. How do you prove malice? You know. Thank you. Thank you.
In light of so many unjust losses of life, Michael Brown walking down the street, Eric Garner selling loose cigarettes, Sandra Bland with maybe a broken taillight. Do you think police should be enforcing essentially minor violations? Should they keep on doing that? One thing I've noticed as I've gone on ride-alongs with police is they crave contact with people, and they don't see it as a negative, and they see it as a community building, really. But I know from the citizen perspective, it can be rather terrifying, as friendly as someone might be. So what's your thoughts on where we are? Should we be enforcing these types of things?
If the community wants those types of things, the answer is yes. But I take a weird view of so-called quality of life issues, broken windows policing, that sort of thing. Watch out for the small stuff. The big stuff will take care of itself. I think there's wisdom to that. I really do. I've seen evidence of it. But why not the community enforcing it? Why not the community accepting stewardship over quality of life ordinances and that sort of thing, in partnership with their partners in blue, but also sanitation and streets and zoning and land use and so on and so forth. So I'm a very strong advocate of what I call true community policing, which is the community policing itself, with a lot of help from a lot of different partners, police among them. So I have a real hard time with police officers who stop citizens without reasonable suspicion and believe that what they have done is lawful. If they want to just meet and greet people in the spirit of building relationships and community policing, well, see, you laugh, and I would say, you know, I did some of that. I did some of that as a chief. Get out of my car and walk for a block and greet people. But there's a whole different demeanor to that kind of a conversation from the kinds of conversations that I see a lot of particularly young, oftentimes impulsive police officers who are just energetic and not appreciative of the fact that an American citizen has a right to walk down the street without being stopped by the cops, absent reasonable suspicion of a crime having been committed, being committed, or about to be committed. That's what the law demands, Terry v. Ohio. And so I don't have much sympathy for police officers who are, back in the day we called it padding the daily, generating activity, putting it on your daily report, and getting brownie points for, quote, productivity. That's about the least productive kind of police work I can imagine.
What kind of role do you think gun control plays in this dialogue, and what should police officers and police leadership be saying about gun control?
Well, back in the 70s, I gave a speech saying that if I were king, nobody but the military and the police would have weapons, firearms. It was 30 seconds before I appreciated just how powerful the NRA is. We're talking about, here we have a police official, I was a middle manager at the time, a police official advocating confiscation of people's weapons against their Second Amendment rights. I believe that comma is so important, and I've now given up totally on the possibility that in my lifetime, or the lifetime of people much younger than I, the Supreme Court would really confront that comma issue. I think that well-regulated militia is an anachronism. It is a thing of the past. And I still feel very strongly that this country can and must set very strict gun control, gun safety laws that would include the registration of all firearms, the licensing of all owners of firearms, predicated on successful completion of a gun safety course that addresses the issue of the legality and the morality as well as the safe handling of a firearm. And I say, what the hell is wrong with that? I mean, people say that the analogy between automobiles, registering them, licensing the people who operate them, and guns and the people who own them is a fallacious kind of an analogy. I think it's perfect. I think it makes absolute sense. We have altogether too many guns. We have more guns than we have adults in this country. And that's hurting so many people, so many families on all sides.
This is a question that's near and dear to my heart. How do you curb the power of the Police Officers Guild, which seems to block every effort at reform?
Well, speaking as a chief who got sued by his guild and taken to the Supreme Court, and winning at the Supreme Court, thank you. I wrote this in my first book, and I won't repeat it from memory. I'm sure I couldn't anyway. I'm a labor guy. I mean, I really am. I'll get teary-eyed if I hear Joe Hill. I will get goosebumps. My kin are out of Harlan County, Kentucky. I think what labor has done for this country is extraordinary in the face of big corporations, in the face of, well, so. And when I wrote about it, I could feel it again. It was a visceral reaction. It was like, my God, organized labor has done so much for the quality of lives of so many people in this country, and it's just wonderful, it's magnificent. Not so much police unions. My attitude about police unions is, I get them, I understand why they're here, and I understand their agenda, I truly do. Police unions were a response to arbitrary and capricious administrative decision-making decades, generations ago. Police administrators, like, for example, I worked in a 400-square-mile city, San Diego. When I became a sergeant, I was doing some staffing work one day, and I was doing scheduling for the following week. And I had the roster, so I knew where every police officer lived, and I had the holes in the schedule that needed to be filled. So I'm thinking, well, we've got Northern Division, the northeastern part of which is up at the Wild Animal Park, and we have San Ysidro right at the border of Mexico. That's like pack a bag for that trip. I mean, it's crazy. And I worked across the desk from another sergeant who purposely would put somebody who lived way up there at the border for a two-night relief or some such thing. Why are you doing that? I won't repeat what he answered. What, Gil, why are you doing this? And that kind of capriciousness, that kind of, I have the power, and I am, by God, I'm going to use it, which is to say, I'm going to abuse it. That went on a lot. And, you know, in the early days, police officers worked 12-hour days, 7 days a week. They got no vacations for like 2 years. I'm not exaggerating. It was awful. It got a little better and a little better and a little better, but it never really got good until police unions showed up. They started as fraternal. They started as associations. In fact, in San Diego, it's still called the Police Officers Association. But make no mistake, they are unions. And they are committed to bread and butter issues and more power to them. I think cops need better pay, better working conditions. I believe very strongly that we need to professionalize, in a kind of slightly different sense of that term, police work. And if we're going to do that, we're going to expect them to master an esoteric body of knowledge that includes interpersonal competence and all kinds of other skills that we don't get enough of. And they're going to have to be really effective at psychomotor skills and a variety of other things that can help prevent accidents and deaths and the like. So we need to pay them for that. But I loved what Judge Robart, is that the name, said to the union. You are being compensated for honoring the Constitution already. I don't want to hear about your contract and why you cannot sign on to an agenda of police reform. Hear, hear. Judges need to say that. Legislators need to say that. Local, state, national. We need, I think, elected officials who will stand up to what we all acknowledge can be, depending on the jurisdiction, a very powerful collection of political supporters. It drives me crazy. It drives me crazy when a management prerogative is given away by elected officials, and I'm talking nationally here. I really am. I'm not talking about King County or Seattle. But I am, in fact, reflecting on some early experiences in San Diego, where the city said, well, you know, we'd like to pay cops more money, but we don't have enough. Why don't we let them decide this? Well, if the this is about transparency and about accountability and a diminution of those two qualities, I can give you 101 reasons why not to give them that. And I think we need to confront the power of police unions in a respectful way, but in a way that really confronts the issues that I think are dividing community and police.
Let's talk about something near and dear to your heart, the war on drug users. When you became a police officer the year before I was born.
Oh, rubber.
The war on drugs had not
I
yet.
Used to really like you.
I know you thanked me already, so I'm good. I don't think the war on drugs was really started up yet, right? And then you policed before the interdiction era started, and now we're seeing a swing in the other direction. Where do you think we are, and what can we do to go further? And do you support the legalization of all drugs?
I'll answer that last. I became a cop in 1966, as I mentioned. Richard Nixon, in June of 1971, famously proclaimed drugs public enemy number one, actually drug abuse public enemy number one, and declared all-out war on them. And at the moment that he used that language, he set America's police officers against their own people. This was a war declared against young people and poor people and people of color. And by the way, explicitly. There's an Oval Office, I urge you to follow up on this if it interests you, an Oval Office conversation about Nixon's plummeting popularity. We've got a very unpopular, controversial war in Southeast Asia. He's in no way assured of re-election. This is pre-Watergate, as a matter of fact. But he's kind of musing. What do we need to do to diminish the negatives and emphasize the positives and so forth? And he struck upon this idea himself and brought it to Ehrlichman and Haldeman. If you were a Watergate junkie like I was, those names just roll off the tongue.
Ehrlichman from Seattle, I believe.
Ehrlichman's daughter, Jan, lives on Orcas Island. She's a wonderful person, loved her father recently died. And we've had a couple of interesting conversations about this Oval Office discussion. They said, what is it that people really hate? What are they afraid of? Well, they're afraid of drugs. They're afraid of drugs. And for good reason. Drugs ruin lives. They shatter the futures of our children and on and on and on. So let's do this. Let's declare war on drugs. And we go after the hippies that way, the anti-war campus unrest hippies. And we can also attack the civil rights insurrectionists in the black community, where drugs are really running rampant. What he, of course, didn't appreciate is that then and now, whites use drugs at roughly the same level as African Americans, but the enforcement is wildly disproportionately directed at people of color, particularly African Americans and Latinos. So he declared war on drugs, and he conscripted America's police as foot soldiers in that war. You don't fight a war without enemies. You don't fight a war without propaganda. This is your brain on drugs, so on and so forth. Let's terrorize the American people and get them to vote for increasingly stringent, indeed draconian penalties for drug use, drug possession, and certainly for drug sales. And it all seemed to make a lot of sense. But when he declared the war, he did, in fact, pit beat cops, uniformed police officers, while we're trying to work with community policing and develop some interesting and I think futuristic concepts about police community relations. And we wind up losing ground dramatically. Not to mention the fact that we have spent $1.3 to $1.5 trillion prosecuting that drug war. It's unwinnable. It's immoral from my point of view. This is my 72-year-old body, and what I decide to put in it ought to be my business. That's one thing I have in common with certain of my libertarian friends. Should I choose to get behind the wheel of a car and drive impaired, to furnish to a child, to engage in any other criminal behavior, fair game for law enforcement. And law enforcement needs to be, I think, robust in the enforcement of those kinds of statutes. So here's the drug war. With all of the drug war propaganda, and then comes 9/11. And we're at war now in two countries, and skirmishes and others, and we have a lot of military surplus building. And first under 1028, then under 1033, the feds say to local law enforcement, here's that MRAP, you know, you've had your eye on. Here's that AK-47 or, you know, AR-15. Here are some toilets and some gym equipment. Here's this, here's that. The reason I'm citing these kinds of things is the feds just started throwing surplus property to local governments across the country. In Morvan, Georgia, anybody know where Morvan is? It's a community that justifies three cops. And they have about $3 million worth of federal surplus in their inventory now, including those toilets, including, by the way, rafts and other kinds of water equipment and waders, where the biggest body of water for miles around is an ankle-deep creek. But it's there, and it's free, so they're taking it. And across the country, this is happening, where military surplus, including particularly military-looking equipment and weaponry, is in fact being granted to local law enforcement. You're familiar with the controversy. There are steps being undertaken to minimize the problems associated with it. There are advocates who say just eliminate the program entirely. Okay, my answer is yes, of course, legalize all drugs. The more dangerous, the more sensational the media coverage, the more frightening the effects of the drug, the greater the justification for legalization. We cannot regulate illicit commerce by definition. The only way that we're actually going to be able to develop control of this country's significant drug problem is to transfer the entire philosophy and all of its programs from the criminal justice system to the public health system. And to treat, thank you. And to treat addiction as the illness that it is. To treat addiction as a medical problem, not a jailable offense. Where we put the police officers once again on that front line doing this nasty business. So yes, I favor ending prohibition, replacing prohibition with a robust regulatory model, and then enforcing all those provisions of the regulatory model. The sky has not fallen with the passage of I-502. I was happy and proud to be a part of that campaign. I want to thank my law enforcement colleagues who also did that. I do believe that we have so much misinformation out there that what's needed is a really strong educational campaign to talk about the effects of the drug war on families. Tens of millions of American citizens in wildly disproportionate numbers, black, poor, and of color, have been incarcerated since Nixon declared that war. Tens of millions. And then white middle-class liberals wring their hands and wonder what's happened, you know, starting all the way back, we can call him a liberal, to Pat Moynihan. Why the, quote, female head of household, as if that's a bad thing. Why are so many young black men in jail? Well, they're in jail and they're in prisons because of our laws. And we're not arresting in anywhere close to the similar numbers whites who engage in the same behavior at essentially the same levels. So for social reasons, for political reasons, for economic reasons, but mostly for moral reasons, we must end the drug war and do it yesterday. Thank you.
We have a lot of great questions left, but I'm told that it's almost time for you to sign books and charm people. But I'm going to end on one that came in from several versions. Norm, when's your novel due out, and is it a murder mystery?
It's a murder mystery. It's a series, and it involves some interesting characters who invented themselves and told me the story to tell, which is juicy. I mean, it's just great. And the short answer is whenever the buzz, whatever level of buzz is generated by this book subsides, then my agent will start shopping it. So who knows? I hope it's a long ways away.
If you could all join me in giving Norm a hand, and thank you.
Thank you.